Our next item is 6B, resolution supporting litigation supporting exempt, exempt to existing sales tax, et cetera, from town.
Mr. Mayor, I have just a couple opening comments as Bill comes up here. The way we're going to do this tonight is Bill has a very short intro, and then TAM's Executive Director, Diane Steinhauser, is going to do a brief presentation as well. TAM has the same question in front of all of the other Marin cities and towns on their agendas over the next month or so, between now and mid-February. And I just wanted to say right up front, and I'm sure it'll probably be echoed by Bill or Diane as well, but the action tonight is not to approve or to endorse a sales tax increase, but it's to support legislation to raise the local sales tax for transportation projects. So as opposed to, there were some questions, I got some emails from community asking if the council is approving or endorsing a sales tax increase. I just want to start off by saying no, that's not what's going on. It's actually more similar to when you're asked to take a position on a bill or some form of legislation, and that would be what the resolution is tonight is, should you choose to adopt the resolution, would be to support legislation to encourage TAM to seek to increase the local sales tax cap for transportation projects. So if the state does grant, if you approve that and the other jurisdictions do that and TAM is able to go forward and the state approves the cap increase, there will still be a whole sales tax measure that will need to be developed. The council and all the councils in Marin will be taking part in an expenditure plan of what will actually be included, and then that will ultimately have to go to the voters, of which you have another opportunity at that point to decide whether the council would be for or against that. But that's a couple steps down the road, and I just want to make that clear up front.
So, thanks, Bill, for doing so. Bill.
It's going to be a very brief introduction. We're looking for a resolution supporting legislation to exempt the existing sales tax cap to accommodate up to a 0.5% for the Transportation Authority of Marin. Diane Steinhauser, the executive director, is here tonight to seek input from the City Council on a possible request for legislation. Diane's going to make her presentation, entertain whatever questions, comments come from the Council, and then we would ask you to consider a resolution to support the legislation.
Thank you. Good evening, Diane. Thanks for being here.
Oh, thank you. Good evening, Mayor, members of the Council. Thank you for the opportunity to come this evening, and thanks to your staff for a very thorough staff report with a lot of useful information on the topic. This is day one of an 18-month process whereby we're looking at options on how to meet transportation needs. What we're asking this evening is for your support of a TAM board decision made back on December 1st to pursue state legislation to provide an exemption to the 2% cap on the local transactions and use tax. I'm going to present a bit of background and process for you to understand while you're considering this request. The TAM board needs to decide if and when to renew our existing transportation sales tax passed by voters in 2004. It expires in 2024-25. Rather than wait until the last few years of that existing sales tax, the board is considering placing before voters a renewal of the sales tax, and they're also considering, and they haven't made a decision yet, on whether to increase the sales tax to address new needs. The issue would need to go before voters in a general election. The next general election where it would be eligible would be 2018. The exemption to the current 2% cap would allow TAM, you, local jurisdictions, and the public to engage in a discussion of whether a new sales tax measure should be pursued. By increasing the cap, it would allow the maximum flexibility for you and the TAM board with respect to what should be placed before voters in terms of any kind of a sales tax increase and approval. The cap exemption needs to be in place before a sales tax measure would go to the ballot. Can anyone raise the sales tax cap? Yes, it does require legislation. There's a poor history of jurisdictions raising the sales tax cap for general purposes, but a strong history and a path to approval through the legislature and by the governor for sales tax cap exemptions associated with transportation needs. As Jim mentioned, are we asking for you to raise the sales tax? No. This is, again, day one of an 18-month process. I hope we can make sure you understand this evening. We're going to be before you again in the future with an expenditure plan and a decision as to whether you support placing a tax on the ballot. So we got a little bit of a cart before the horse issue here, in that we need to introduce legislation this year. The legislative introduction deadline is February. It's coming up on us fast. And do we want to allow this community discussion to occur with a maximum flexibility of what's being considered? I recognize fully that not knowing what will be in the expenditure plan and what needs in San Rafael will be met, it could make this a difficult decision for you at this time. But we do want to explain the process that we will be engaged with you over time. A ballot measure, if we so choose to do this, would need a two-thirds majority approval. What is the amount of a higher sales tax? Is it a renewal of the existing? Is it an additional amount? Has not yet been determined. We would be constrained, however, with how much of a sales tax increase could be considered. So this is existing January 1st, 2017. Tax levels for all the jurisdictions in Marin. As you can see down there at the bottom, both San Rafael and the town of Fairfax have an existing 9% sales tax effective January 1st. The current statewide sales tax level is 7.25. It had been 7.50, as you probably know, and Prop 55 reduced it to 7.25%. With the state revenue loss being made up other ways. So there is capacity within the existing sales tax structure to seek an increase in sales tax by either the city or by the county up to the 9.25%. Part of what we're wanting to do in seeking your support for is the idea of identifying a slice of this sales tax structure for transportation, thereby protecting you or any jurisdiction that may want to consider a sales tax in the future of their own. So this idea of a part of the sales tax reserved for transportation to be pursued by TAM is what we're seeking to put into place. This has been done in many other jurisdictions around the state for transportation purposes. You have, as part of your package that came to you from staff, a listing, a history of where this has been pursued elsewhere. If there is community interest in having TAM expand the sales tax cap, then cities near the cap would be restricted, and in effect the county would be restricted in how much cap how much sales tax it could pursue. It would also constrain future considerations by you or other jurisdictions on raising the sales tax on their own. So let me just keep going here. One of the benefits of our own transportation sales tax in Marin is it is local funding that we control. If you looked at this chart 30 years ago in the 80s, When I started working in transportation, you'd see a huge majority of funds from the federal and state level. Right now, in our fiscal year 14-15 World of Transportation funding in Marin, this is what we have as transportation funding. The majority of our funds come from local sources. We also get some funds from the region, from MTC, and with respect to tolls. But the state and federal funding has slowed to a crawl, and we're not necessarily hopeful that the state and feds are going to come through with additional funds in the coming year. So should we answer and address some of these transportation needs with more funds generated at the local level? Our existing half-cent transportation sales tax funds these features here. There are 24 counties statewide now that have local transportation sales taxes. Most of these counties, interestingly, have the bulk of the funds going into capital projects. We're unique in Marin in that a good portion of our funds, 79.25%, is dedicated to the operation of ongoing programs. So I'll give you a couple examples. Sonoma has over 70% of their quarter cent sales tax for transportation dedicated to capital projects. When they renew their sales tax, they now have 70% they can assign to new things. Not true in case of Marin's sales tax, because 79.25% is dedicated to ongoing programs. Do we want to cut or reorder those ongoing programs to address new needs? And some of the new needs that have come to our attention that we've had to say no to are funds for local school bus service, more funds for senior mobility, more funds for local street and road rehab, more funds for operational upgrades to local roads, smart signals, and those kinds of systems, pedestrian improvements, and a new category that's cropped up and very relevant recently is mitigation for local transportation facilities associated with adaptation and resiliency to sea level rise. There's a great dearth of funds for us to be able to address sea level rise and its impact on transportation. So, granted, if we renew the sales tax solely, there is 13.25% that can be reassigned. Honestly, the board is looking at that top figure of 79.25% dedicated to the operation of ongoing programs as a very tough decision to redirect those funds when they're so strongly supporting local transit, safe routes to school, and the maintenance of local roads. Giving up any of those to create room for something new is something the TAM board's going to have to consider. And in our finding those initial discussions difficult. So is it feasible to raise the sales tax? We're required, again, day one of an 18-month process, we're required under state law to get approval of our member jurisdictions, including you, once an expenditure plan is developed. Right now, we're looking to introduce legislation that we hope could be approved in 2017. This is, again, a 6 or 8 month process to work through the legislature to raise the cap. Starting in the May-June timeframe through the end of the year, maybe into January of 2018, the TAM board ideally would create an expenditure plan advisory committee with very broad membership that would have both geographical as well as topical membership around the county to sit down and look at what are our needs. If we were going to raise the tax, what would we raise it by, and what would that fund? And is that something we want to ask voters? What this all comes down to is giving us the opportunity to bring this to voters. You know, would voters, again, with a two-thirds majority approval, agree to raise the tax, and for what? The draft expenditure plan would come back to you after the expenditure plan advisory committee brings it through the TAM board in the spring of 2018, about a year from now. So you will have another significant bite of the apple in terms of membership on that advisory committee. Should we raise the tax? What should we raise it to? What does that fund? All those questions are things that we still have to answer. So, again, there's a path of approval for these types of sales tax cap increases for filling transportation needs. And the governor has rejected, incidentally, raising of the cap for general purposes. So there's been some protection there. We're recommending your support for the introduction of legislation of providing an exemption of up to 0.5%. We're looking at Senator Mike McGuire as a likely sponsor. We're also keeping Assemblyman Mark Levine informed. Again, there will be future action before your council on both membership input into what's in the plan, approval of that plan, and placement of the measure on the ballot. So, first step, and I'd be glad to answer any questions.
Thank you, and we'll entertain questions and ask for the public comment. So, from the council, any questions of staff, including Diane?
Diane, you made a comment early on in your presentation that I think may resonate with a lot of folks, and it was a question about not knowing the elements of the expenditure plan may make this decision a difficult one. So the question I have is the obvious one. Why did you decide to move in this order? Why not instead convene a panel of folks, stakeholders across the community, come up with a draft expenditure plan and present that so that we, as the policymakers here locally, are able to determine whether what's in the expenditure plan is likely to be something that our electorate would want us to remove the shield against higher local taxation so that they could vote on it?
That, and you know, that's a very good question. The needs before us are great. Sitting in the "can you please find money for us" seat, we have needs brought to our attention on a weekly basis. How to address those needs is difficult. The OBAG cycle, of which the city received a good share of funds, is it for 5 years when it comes to federal funds. On the state front, we're unsure if the state has the will to address transportation needs. So how can we address these needs? The earliest that we could bring something to the voters to consider would be 2018. That puts us in the difficult position of having to protect local jurisdictions and what they are intending to pursue with the cap and addressing that in 2017. So, we need to take that action legislatively in order to put anything on the ballot. We can't do it in the same year. The registrars made it very clear that if we put something on the ballot, it's going to have to be conditional on the governor approving legislation, which would be very difficult, and I don't think that we would end up pursuing this in 2018. So we go through this process of developing an expenditure plan. We know a lot by next fall as to whether we should put this on the ballot or not. At the end of that initial expenditure plan advisory committee process, we seek legislation after that, then we're looking at 2020. And you know, that is an option. Don't get me wrong, that we want to wait and do it then. We would then collect in 2021, which is 4 years from now. So, you know, the message to the voters is we can't do this. We need to wait. And the TAM board, I think, has looked favorably at 2018 and cutting short that timeline. And I do recognize that your authority over this could be conditional on another bite of the apple, could be conditional on a lot of additional discussion. And again, this is a procedural step. This doesn't guarantee that we raise the tax or we go to the ballot. So in some ways, I don't want to call it incidental, but I really want to focus on the process that we have coming up with respect to engaging you and the public and interest groups and advocacy on should we do this and what should be in there. And that's going to happen regardless. But if we sit here a year from now and you go, I like this plan, and I can see there's going to be this money for San Rafael, let's do it. I'm going to sit there and go, okay, it's 2020. That's the best I can do at that moment in time. So it's challenging in that you don't have everything in front of you. But it's an initial procedural step with you having the right and authority to whether to do this or not in the future.
Other questions? Please, yes.
Would the term non-binding be a good one to describe this?
non-binding in terms of pursuing a sales tax on the ballot is absolutely the case. And a good message, I think, because we're in day one of an 18-month process. Yeah.
Thank you.
Kate.
I had a quick question. Thank you, Diane. One of the comments you made was, saving a slice of the tax, transportation tax from Marin, but we have that already. I mean, when you said in your presentation, so I mean, as I understand, I'm just making sure that I'm not missing that because it seems like that already exists.
We have an existing half cent transportation sales tax. It's applied all over Marin. Okay. Do we want to increase it? Is the question. And again, it's the challenges of fitting anything else into the plan because just by renewal, we aren't freeing up a lot of money.
No, I understand
that. So we would reserve a slice within the cap by raising the cap to 2.5. We'd reserve a slice for transportation between 2 and 2.5. Everything within the 2% cap is still available to local jurisdictions to operate under. As well as the county. So this would be just a unique slice within that 2.5%.
An additional slice.
Correct.
So it wasn't really saving
additional.
It because
correct.
That's already in there. Okay,
correct.
Thank you.
John?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks, Diane. So I'm looking at the numbers right now as it stands without any increase. What was it, 79% goes to... Is that right? Is it 79.2?
Operation of ongoing programs. Yeah.
Operational ongoing programs. So just with some back of the napkin math, if we're estimating $25 million generated coming in on the current measure, that leaves about $6 million a year for projects to be funded out of TAM. And I know we have a lot of requests for these funds. Can you maybe give me an idea of, you know, after the 101 gap closure, you know, what are some of the projects that have been funded with that additional $6 million to the extent of how big some of those have been? Because to be honest, and this is just an observation, I tried to find this information on your website, and your website, you know, is not up to date. I looked at the grand jury report for web transparency, and you guys weren't included because they couldn't find your website. So those things, to me, not only as a council member, but as a citizen trying to find this, to get information on this, was very discouraging that I couldn't find those projects. So if you could enlighten me a little bit on, let's just say last year, you know, how much of that
Absolutely.
Funding was came from TAM for other projects?
Absolutely. And again, we're getting ready to launch our own beta site on February 1st. We learned a lot and want to congratulate you on the restructuring of your website. We also started last spring in trying to update the site, and congratulations to you and to Rebecca especially for a great job on that. So we hope to correct, you know, your ability to find information very soon. The 7.5% going to the HOV gap closure was the segment in San Rafael that was completed in 2010. So that money was generated and spent. The other capital projects are in a category we call major roads. So San Rafael, by the way, was the first jurisdiction that developed a major road project, we paid $4.25 million out of the sales tax for the improvements on 4th Street West End. Okay. Miller Avenue, under construction right now, is paid primarily from the transportation sales tax. The next project, which you are starting here in Marin, is the 3rd Street corridor. And I know we've approved funds for you to start looking at what needs to be done on 3rd Street. We have 15 corridors in the sales tax we were hoping to do improvements to. Under the complete streets concept, what we learned on 4th Street and what we learned on Miller Avenue is that when you address the needs of all users, the project cost goes up substantially. And the money that was originally envisioned that would cover these 15 corridors, there's really about, you know, 7 or 8 corridors that we're going to be able to address. And so many jurisdictions aren't going to see that bit of funds come their way. So there's interest in reauthorizing the sales tax to keep providing that stream and perhaps increasing it for those major road projects. So we do have a deficit and a need to address all of the major road projects. Now, if I may, if what you're asking is what else might we consider, that's really part of this process that we need to engage in starting later this spring. What other capital improvement projects should we be looking at? We have a dearth of funds for improvements around schools. We have a dearth of funds for interchanges with 101. We've completed a study at Tiburon East Blythedale. We completed a study at Paradise Tamalpais. There was also a study completed at Atherton in Novato. And I know there's interest and some activity in San Rafael for several of your interchanges. There's no fund sources to address any of those. So could interchanges with 101 be a future sales tax category, perhaps? We're looking at Sir Francis Drake, and there's a dearth of funds to complete everything the county wants to do on that segment of Drake. One of the things that we're trying to do on Drake is this smart signal interconnection so that we can maximize the operation on that corridor. We have no fund source for these smart systems, and that's something, because we can't widen, that we're going to have to get better at is operating our existing facilities as well as we can. So those are just a couple of the capital ideas that have come to me in terms of, can we find funding for this, and we've had to say no to.
So when we're doing these studies and these, you mentioned a number of them, we're doing those without any funding sources.
Correct.
To complete these. So what's the typical cost of one of those studies?
Oh, my gosh. Probably 100, maybe to 125,000, sometimes less. Those basic planning studies are to engage the community and get an understanding of what needs to be done. In terms of competing for discretionary fund sources, one of the first questions is, does your community agree on what needs to be done at that location? And so for all of those that have been studied, that was what we accomplished. We accomplished an agreement with the adjacent communities of what all the constituent needs are. And once that is done, then you can take parts of the projects and seek discretionary funds, grant funds, basically, to try and get the work accomplished. Not much different from the money that we identified and spent a year ago to look at what can we do with the multi-use path. Is there room without buying significant right-of-way to construct the multi-use path? TAM funded a small study, $60,000, took a look at that, and the answer, with enough information to engage SMART, was yes, it's possible to fit both of these in, we believe. And so that kicked off a more detailed design and environmental study, which is what Bill referred to earlier.
I guess I'm just have some concerns with, we do a lot of studies. We spend a lot of money on a lot of studies, knowing that we don't have the funding to, you know, you you keep saying that there's a dearth of funding in all of these situations that the state and federal sources are drying up, and yet we still continue to spend sales tax money on projects and doing studies that don't seem to get done or don't have the funding to get done, and then those studies will probably have to be done again, you know, 6 years from now or 10 years from now when there might be some funding sources available. Would it be better suited to, you know, utilize those funds for projects that actually are ready and not, and to cut back on the studies that we continue to do? And I might be completely off on this, but I wanted to ask this question of you in terms of projects that are moving forward or just completed in the last year. The Central Marin Ferry Crossing bridge, how much funding came from specifically from TAM, if any, or was that TAM led the project but got source funding from other places? And then also on the third deck Richmond Bridge bike path, how much is being allocated from TAM, if any? Or because I read their websites and see in conjunction with Buried Transit Authority and MTC and TAM's included in that. And I'm just wondering, has there been any allocation of funds or dedication of funds to those projects?
Let me talk about both of those. That new bike bridge over Sir Francis Drake came through Regional Measure 2, which was a toll increase in 2004, specifically mentioned in the legislation. It had three primary fund sources. One was the toll funds, the Regional Measure 2, mentioned in the legislation, approved by the CMA, by TAM in a former life, as well as by MTC. Second fund source was the Non-Motorized Transportation Pilot Program, which was the $25 million that Marin got from the federal government to look at critical transportation bike network needs, and it received funds from that. It also received a minor amount of money from transportation funds for clean air, which is what we receive in Marin to consider bicycle needs, and the project had a shortfall. And so it received some funds from that bike account.
Really quick on this piece. So when looking at those and going out for fundings and getting these $25 million funding for that project, you know, I, as a passerby driving by that every day for the last couple of years during the construction, it was very apparent to me that they're less than an eighth of a mile east of Sir Francis Drake is another bicycle pedestrian overcrossing over Sir Francis Drake that leads right into the Larkspur Ferry Terminal. And I'm saying to myself, okay, so why are we building this other one, other than there's funds here and it might be more convenient to connect north-south? But is that, if we're going out and asking for these funds and there's this dearth of funding for other projects and we're using it on a project that, in my opinion, is not immediately necessary because we have an existing bike and pedestrian overcrossing less than an eighth of a mile away serving the same purpose, is that the best use of those funds or the request of those funds, or if we just get it, let's just spend it? And that's kind of the way it feels to me, unless someone can tell me that that bridge is going to be taken down an eighth of a mile east of where it is right now. So, you know, this leads to my point is, as Councilmember McCullough asked, is what projects do we have out on that we're looking out in the forefront? If we're being asked to endorse an increase on a sales tax cap without knowing what future projects there are, and this is the kind of history where we're saying we're getting money, be it might not be from TAM, might be from other sources, but we're endorsing that or putting in those projects, it just seems like we're building projects for project's sake in some of these cases.
Well, look, the crossing an eighth of a mile east of the existing crossing is a private structure. It's owned by the Country Mart. It is not open for general public use. Therefore, when it was considered what is the most important bicycle facility to address safety in the vicinity of Drake and the new smart station in Larkspur and how people are going to get across Drake from the smart station, that's how that structure was born. It was born in 2002-03 when there was consideration for what should be included in a toll program. How can we increase trips that aren't driving trips in the vicinity of the toll corridor, and that bridge got its funding from that discussion. The non-motorized transportation pilot was a nine-month process of all the jurisdictions sitting down to prioritize what should be done with the $25 million from the federal government. Again, that structure was a priority in terms of addressing safety of people crossing Drake and not being able to use that private structure, which was an eighth of a mile away. And there is now that there is now a very workable Country Mart team, but that hasn't always been the case. And so in 2003, that wasn't the case, that private structure was available for general usage. And that's how the genesis of that project occurred. Let me go back a minute to the planning studies.
Sure.
We are given planning funds by MTC that are we need to spend on planning activity. So the Tiburonies Blacktail planning, your San Rafael Transit Center planning, the planning associated with the multi-use path, those were all paid for out of funds that were restricted to planning only. And so, you know, we too, again, with the direction of the board, like to spend the funds on projects that get built. But in many cases, the details regarding the eligibility of the funds control what it is we can do. The last thing you mentioned was the upper deck
right.
on the Richmond Bridge. That is solely being funded by the Berea Toll Authority with no funds from the Transportation Authority of Marin. Let me mention that our MTC Commissioner, Steve Kinsey, and our new Commissioner, Damon Connolly, have both made it very clear to the Berea Toll Authority that their goal is to relieve traffic congestion in Marin with the operation of the third lane. It was BATA's sole decision to put the bike path on the upper deck. You know, I talk about this around the county. It's part of the Bay Trail system. It's strongly demanded and supported by the Bike Coalition in both the East Bay and in Marin. It's going to happen. And that, again, was a decision by the Berea Toll Authority to spend the funds that way to try and encourage, here we go, the non-motorized travel, which we all are behind as a policy. And they decided to make this investment.
Sure. I get that. I just have to cut two more things, and I'll cut my time here. The first thing, getting back to the overcrossing with the Larkspur Country Mart, I did not know that. But did anybody think to just ask if they could buy it from them?
You know, I'd have to look back at the history in 2002.
Because I would imagine it'd probably be a lot cheaper to understand than $25 million that they would probably have. And that's where I'm getting at this is the – when we see these projects that come forth, and you know, you look at the MTC's webpage and talking about the third lane on the Richmond Bridge for the bicycles, and TAM's you know logo is right there as a supporter of that. All we look to as citizens is saying, okay, so TAM's supporting a $25 million movable bike lane on top of the Richmond Bridge that by all accounts is not going to be used by many people. And is that the best use of funds? Going back to the MTC planning funds, just because they're there doesn't mean we have to spend them. Just because it's from MTC doesn't mean it's not coming from all of our pocketbooks. And having that fiscal responsibility to say, you know what, we don't have funding set up to do these projects, so why are we going to take your funding for planning? Maybe some other jurisdiction has funding set up for another project, and they can use those planning funds for that. It just doesn't make sense. And when you're asking us to endorse an increase on the sales tax cap that would put San Rafael, I think, at an economic disadvantage by having the highest sales tax, if any place in the Marin County, based on, you know, customers are going to shop online, or they're going to go to Corte Madera, or they're going to go to Novato, where they can save 1.5% because their sales tax is less than ours. So I don't want to put that burden. We're trying to grow and our economic development and entice people to come here and entice people to shop here. But if we're saying, yeah, come pay a 10% sales tax to support projects that we don't know are going to exist, and you know, that's my comment on that. I am not seeking an answer, but that's my comment on it. Thank you.
And thank you. I do want to open. I sit on the TAM board, as you know, so I've heard most of the questions and the answers as well. So let me open for public comment.
Good evening. I'm Mimi Willard, a founding core group member of the Coalition of Sensible Taxpayers, which exists to protect Marin taxpayer rights and interests. I'm here tonight to encourage you not to endorse today. Please take more time. Endorsing this proposal gives momentum to something that really needs careful consideration and ample opportunity for substantial constituent education, outreach, and input, including both residents and businesses in San Rafael that are already struggling with the highest sales tax in Marin. Also, I would note that providing the notice over a big holiday weekend does not allow a full airing of an important issue. Now, I recognize that it is not primarily the fault of the San Rafael City Council that you're under this time pressure. TAM and its lobbyists have set a time schedule that puts time pressure on all of the Marin cities to endorse by early February. And without endorsement from them all, the legislation will not proceed. But Measure A doesn't expire until 2014-15. This time pressure does not conform with your good intentions that you've stated for good public outreach. TAM has been considering what's happening, what's being proposed to you tonight for over a year. And so there was plenty of time had they moved forward sooner than December 1 of 2016 for you to properly consider whether to support this process, to engage the public, to make sure that there is a robust list of expenditures outlined, had they acted sooner, had they not waited until December of 2016. This is contrary to San Rafael's interests. There's taxpayer exhaustion. Do you want transportation money for TAM to take top priority, because the next time that you need money for San Rafael, people will have gone over that tax exhaustion threshold? I know that you've received lots of messages from constituents today asking you not to rubber stamp a process that uses taxpayer money on something that's intended to lead to yet more taxes.
Can you wrap it up, please?
Yes, I will. Many are also concerned that the transportation money doesn't seem to be spent on things that actually reduced traffic. Finally, I will point out that TAM has not consistently respected restrictions placed on their current sales tax revenues under Measure A. They did seek to use, and I believe did use, the consent calendar to swap restricted funds with other agency in order to gain access to unrestricted funds. For all of these reasons, I urge you to slow down, invite more public participation, and heed their guidance before you vote.
Thank you. Thank you. Next person, please.
Hi, Susan Kirsch. I, too, am one of the core founding members of the group called Coalition of Sensible Taxpayers. And I want to, thank you for being here for the presentation, Diane. And it's just, because I've not been sitting in meetings like this lately, it's just really is interesting to kind of hear the bureaucratic talk about a project which some of us consider is a part of the OPM addiction, other people's money, and what can be done with other people's money. And this would seem to be one of those things where the legislation exists to protect people in the public. And so I would agree with everything that Mimi said about the importance of being able to be the agency that considers this resolution in looking at your responsibility for protecting the public from information that has not been forthcoming, and that there has not been a kind of the self-inflicted urgency of this is one of the aspects that is problematic for those of us in communities who are struggling to keep on top of what the information is that's coming our way. So, you know, and the resolution says that this is similar to resolutions that have been passed in Los Angeles or San Mateo or Costa Contra County. Marin is such a different kind of county. We're a little county without nearly the building or the transportation requirements that those other counties have. So again, I would urge you to do the protection, keep the cap in place as we need the cap, and know that there is time then to reconsider it. And we as a cost organization will be doing our part to try to educate the public about expenditures and how they're needed and how the money's being used. Thank you.
Thanks, Susan. Next person, please. Good evening.
Mary, how are you? Good. Mr. Mayor, Councilman, my name is Hutch Turner. The remark was made earlier that this was not binding, but it is enabling, and that's my concern. I heard a lot of bureaucratic talk here. I hear a lot of it. I'm a simple person, like most of the people who live in this county. When I get up in the morning and I have to go somewhere, I get in my car and I drive on a road, and it's in terrible shape. Terrible shape. I pick up the newspaper, I read about a new interchange. Well, I'm on that interchange very briefly, but I'm on my city streets a lot. And that's very distressing, and that's a source of great unrest in this county, among all cities. In addition, when I get home, I pick up the newspaper and I read about a new tax for schools because they don't have enough money. So we have a lot of things going on here if you're a small, simple person trying to lead a simple life in this county. All of the bureaucratic back and forth doesn't mean much. Once it leaves this chamber, it's out of the locals' hands because it's taken over by people who are appointed, and it gets further and further away from the person who drives on the street every day. In Novato, we have a bus terminal that is 8 times larger than any projected need in the near term. 8 times. It was pushed by TAM. Second thing that really annoys a lot of us is we're beginning to feel increasingly estranged from city government. And I'll tell you right now, you have no greater leverage on behalf of your citizens as you do when you make a decision like you make tonight. I suggest respectfully that you hit the pause button and engage the citizens so they'll have a fuller understanding of what's going on. Thank you.
And thank you. Anyone else? Close and come back for comment, and perhaps you could amplify on the timing issue, which has come up several times, why it's critical to make a decision, if critical is the right choice of words, significant to make a decision at this point in time as opposed to a later point in time.
Well, we're trying to meet the legislative deadline of introducing legislation in February. There is a long legislative process that needs to occur between February and, let's say, August or September for legislation to be approved. So there is time within that period for additional activity. Introducing the legislation gives us an opportunity, obviously, to address the cap issue this year so that we can finalize an expenditure plan, perhaps, and bring it to the voters next year. So we're in a situation of trying to take a procedural step that clears the way for more conversation is what we're trying to do at this time.
Reference was made to the chambers, and once the decision leaves the chambers, then it's left to, I'll say, others. Could you describe the makeup of the TAM board?
Absolutely. The TAM board has all five members of the Board of Supervisors and a representative from each of the 11 cities and towns. It is a fully representative board. And again, to emphasize, it's a requirement within our legislation, state creation of TAM, that if we plan to renew a sales tax via going to the ballot or increase a sales tax via going to the ballot, we need to get the approval of our member agencies of an expenditure plan and the placement of that tax on the ballot. Once it's on the ballot, it requires a two-thirds majority approval. And that's all part of the, again, required legal process in going forward with this.
And when the this matter came before the board made up of the county supervisors, each and every one, and representatives, including myself, from the various cities within the jurisdiction, what was the vote?
The Board of Supervisors approved this legislation in an action in December as a body. The vote at TAM was unanimous that we go forward with seeking the legislation, again, with the clear understanding that there's a lot of process ahead with respect to if we and what do we put before voters in terms of a renewal or expansion of a sales tax.
And just to perhaps expand on, or maybe for the first time, comment on the reason why I voted in favor of this. I see this to include everything certainly was presented by our staff and Diane, but I also see as an opportunity for our community as a whole to make a decision once they're fully informed. And this is the first step. This is not an informative step, but rather this opens the door wherein then the plan would be brought to the voters requiring two-thirds of the voters. So for me, it seems to be an opportunity for the community to tell us what they would like to see done with regard to transportation. You hear about potholes and you hear about the traffic concerns and certainly many other issues surrounding transportation. That's one of the things I hear as much as anything almost these days. And so this is not an endorsement. This is not us saying one way or another at this point in time, but rather it creates an opportunity for the community-wide to address the issue if they so desire. If the list is desirable, the voters will say yes. If it's not, the voters will say no. And that's all we're doing is creating, in my mind anyway, creating this opportunity to reach out to the community to say, what do you want us to do, folks? And that's the reason why I voted in favor, and various other reasons, but it was unanimous among that group. Questions or comments with staff? Yes, Mary Beth.
Question for Dan. The vote you're asking us to make tonight would lift the cap so that we can go forward with the question. With first an expenditure plan. What happens if the expenditure plan is brought forward and we decide for whatever reason that it's not adequate and we don't support it? Does the cap remain lifted or does the cap come back down?
Most legislation that we've seen would raise the cap for a limited period of time.
Okay, so there's a sunset date.
Okay. So if you especially, as the largest city in the county, say, yeah, I don't think so. I don't know, but I would venture to say it would be very hard for the TAM board to proceed. So not proceeding with any increase. Do we do a renewal? Maybe, maybe not. The cap sunsets, and we're back to the drawing board for a future general election.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Next person?
Go ahead. Just work way down this way. I have comments as well.
Comment would be appropriate at this time. Andrew.
Well, I'm just going to come out and say it, Diane. While I'm very supportive of TAM's mission and the challenges it's facing with the limited funds available for the many, many desirable projects that are constantly being requested of it, or funds being requested of it, I have a difficult time with this one for many of the comments that we've heard here tonight. And Even though we as a body are somewhat attenuated from the ultimate inflicting of pain that is exceeding the cap, it doesn't give me a lot of comfort that there are several more steps before that pain occurs. What I'd like to see is the expenditure plan in front of me so that I have a clear understanding of what it is that I would be asking or supporting by way of supporting this measure, that the legislature increase the cap so that we can put it to the voters whether or not the expenditure plan is desirable and therefore the increase in the tax rate is desirable. I do feel that as a matter of principle that the 2% cap is there for a reason and it's designed to protect our constituents, and we're here for the same reason unless we see a compelling reason to depart from it. And what I'm hearing from you is not that there's a compelling reason, but there's a compelling time frame or chronology. The fact that we lose potentially a year or two, so we hit this in 2020, assuming all goes well, as opposed to 2018, would likely mean that worthwhile projects would be delayed or possibly not funded. But I think that's a reasonable risk if it means that we have the community behind us in supporting what appear to be good, solid projects in the offing. That's my view on it.
I'll be a little bit out of order, but I'd only suggest that before this matter proceeds, you'll get what you have asked for. And before we would proceed with regard to any endorsement or we think it's an okay idea, whatever the comments might be, that would be required and certainly is being developed. So it wouldn't preclude you from drawing conclusion that these projects are not appropriate or not work, what, you know, however you wish to frame them. This step tonight doesn't preclude that, decision or that review process. I think it's much more limited than, like I said, I think it really just opens a possibility for the voters to decide.
Can I ask a question along those lines? Please. If we were to express our support tonight for raising the cap, could we condition that support upon having a veto? That is, we as a council having a veto on whatever expenditure plan may come before us later on.
Thank you, Bill. There's 12 jurisdictions in the county, and as mentioned, you're our largest. You saying no to the expenditure plan is going to have a profound impact on whether we go forward or not. So in that regard, you have that authority. If you look at the strict letter of the law, could TAM go forward if the other 11 jurisdictions say yes? Possibly. But again, I'd venture to say that with a two-thirds majority needed, that we would not proceed if San Rafael said no. I think that's very safe to say. Not in a two-thirds environment.
Kate.
So I have some comments as well.
Sure.
And they actually echo what Councilmember McCullough just said about slowing down and recognizing that this legislation at the state level exists for a reason. And for me, I appreciate a lot of the emails that we got, and it really highlighted that there are two issues the way that I see it. In terms of San Rafael, if we're lifting the cap, we're getting up in the high regions in terms of our sales tax. I don't have enough information as to know the impact on our community. Some of the emails suggested there might be an impact to our businesses, our economy, or to maybe underserved populations or to low-income populations. I don't have enough information on that. I would want to know that, because when I look at that graph of where we all are in Marin County, we're at the high end. So that, to me, it's combined with this issue, but it's separate. So I feel that homework needs to be done on our end. I'd want to know how we compare to other cities in California, and I'm sorry that we don't have that information, too, because that, to me, is linked. I also agree with Councilmember McCullough. Transportation needs are real, and how to fund them is huge. All we have to do is drive down and see the potholes on 4th Street. But I also think that's a separate conversation from the sales tax, and I also would want more work on defining all the projects that need to be done. And I did want to say that I was grateful to the voters that supported Measure E, and we had an increase that was for a central facility here in San Rafael. And we were really thrilled that that passed, and we really thought a lot about that, and I'm glad that our residents saw that that was viable. So I would propose that we also slow down, and I love the idea of the Expenditure Plan Advisory Committee, and maybe that gets formed now, and they start to look at the current ongoing programs, right? So you're talking about a much broader group, and I respect all the work that TAM does. It's well represented across the community in terms of electeds. I like that idea of having kind of broad input into that. Maybe they help the TAM board look at, are all these ongoing programs continuing funded at the same levels or not? Because I absolutely agree those are difficult conversations to have. But recognizing that, you know, our neighbors to the north, they switched it in terms of capital and programs, I'd be curious as to know why. So those are the comments that I have.
John.
My comments are that, you know, we have a cap in place for a reason. It's to keep us in line with our spending limits and our spending goals. And if we just want to keep going over that, then why have a cap at all? Because the next time we need another project and that's we've hit our cap, someone's going to go else back and say, well, we need to increase our cap again. It's the same thing we're seeing on the national level when we look at our spending there and our caps that we keep just saying, okay, let's go ahead and increase those. And where does it stop is my question. Because if we're not living within the means that we have now, you know, we just there is that going to be that taxpayer just feeling of just when is enough enough? You look at your property tax bill, and it's almost two pages long. Now you start adding the sales tax again and again. If we knew what this was going to be funded for, it'd be a little bit easier to kind of look at these decisions and say, okay, there's where that's money going to be allocated. And I know that's not all on you, Diane. And the timing is very challenging for me to be put in a position that we have to do this now or we run the risk of it not making this legislative session. Okay. If we knew about this 6 months ago, a year ago at TAM, and then we only acted on it on the TAM board in December, knowing that we're going to have this short time frame, I think that's short-sighted. I think I don't think the effort was put forth to saying that nobody was going to. It almost seems like it was going to be a pre-assumed that everybody would support this. And I would be interested, and maybe I'll go back and watch the TAM video if those are on there for the meeting to see what kind of questions were asked by the TAM board when this was put to them and they voted unanimously about that. Because I'd be questioning why. If they didn't have some of these same questions that we're asking now, of why not an expenditure plan ahead of time? Why put this before that? So I just can't see supporting this at this point. You know, that might be if we have time over the next year and this goes on to the next legislative session. You know, it's a different thing. It'll give us time to hear from our citizens and to really get an idea of what this money's going to be used for.
Well, this is getting to an interesting place, and I understand the comments made, and I certainly agree with many of my council members. And it still strikes me, however, one, John, when you make reference to the expenditures and the cap, that's a decision not of us. We aren't making that decision, but rather that's a decision that the community would make. They would decide whether or not they wish to increase the sales tax that they would be paying. So it's not a deficit situation, rather it's a revenue source that, again, they're going to decide, just like our community decided that our plan with regard to the public safety and the fire stations was a good thing that they wanted to pay for. I don't chastise them for stepping up to pay. I recognize it's their decision. And I would suggest that this is also their decision. And it creates an opportunity for us to say, here are some, and we don't have it before us, I'll grant you that, but it's going to be here before a decision would be made, because remember, it would come back to us to further endorse the plan. And at that point in time, we can say we don't like the plan. We can say whatever we want about it. This is not a decision point at this point in time. We're not making that decision tonight. What we're doing is creating an opportunity for our community who complains about, and rightfully so, the condition of our transportation and our roads, and creates us an opportunity for us to say, we're willing to step up to give the opportunity, and you guys decide how strongly you feel about the transportation situation you keep complaining about, rather than us going, well, we're not quite ready to make that decision, we'll make it a couple years from now, when it isn't even our decision. It will be their decision to make. It's not our decision.
No, I agree. I agree with you on that. But this is their decision. And why don't we hear from them on whether or not they want us to endorse an increased funding cap?
It's not an endorsement, John.
It is.
We're not endorsing.
That's what the staff report says. If the staff report doesn't say that, I'm mistaken. But it's asking for an endorsement of TAM's request for legislation to be put forth by Senator McGuire to request an increase of the cap. So if Senator McGuire is going to go and put this in front of the legislation and come back and say, I have the endorsement of all the cities and towns, shouldn't our citizens be able to tell us that's what they want us to do? And we haven't given them time.
They will have the opportunity.
They'll have the opportunity to vote on a tax, yes, on an increase for thing. But shouldn't they also be given the opportunity to tell us that they wish us to support and endorse the? This is not just hey, willy nilly, let's take the cap off. And I don't think that you feel that way. But it's basically we're going forth and putting our stamp of endorsement to TAM that Senator McGuire is going to take to the legislature and say, look, I've got the support of every single town and city in Marin to go ahead and increase this or do the exemption for this cap here. But if our citizens are telling us they don't want us to do that, shouldn't that count for something?
But that's my point. They have,
haven't given them time.
They're going to have the opportunity, if we pass on this, to make that decision. What they feel is in their best interest when they compare or weigh sales tax that they're going to be paying versus what they're going to get. If they decide not to, then that's the decision, and we all live with that. If, on the other hand, they decide that the items that we'll see before we take our next step, which is incumbent upon us, before they will then decide yes or no. And I think that we need to create that opportunity for them. We're prejudging. We're saying, oh, they're not going to pay it, or whatever. And we haven't even seen the list. Kate's right. We haven't seen, quote, the list of benefits.
No,
and I'll grant you that.
But
that's not the issue before us.
Well, the issue before us is for us to give the city's endorsement to TAM's request to go forth to Senator McGuire to sponsor this legislation. So by him having that, he's basically saying Santa Fe supports this lift on this cap. What I'm saying is that we're being brought this on January 17th. We're being brought this on January 17th. The first time we've seen this, the first time we've heard about this, asked to be make this decision tonight, because if we don't, then it's going to turn over to another legislative session. So that, and we haven't had any input other than from the five or six folks here today, because it just came out on the agenda item last Thursday on a holiday weekend. And I just don't think that's enough time for everybody. You've received them as well, 10 to 15 plus emails just in a short amount of time, and looking at the next door and looking at the other piece. People are asking us not to do this. I didn't receive one email from anybody saying, please do this. Every single one of them. So that tells me that they need more time to understand this.
And I'll grant you that would be beneficial. I don't debate that for a second. I think Jim wants to make
Yeah, thank you. Mayor, we included a couple options in the staff report, which basically were support the legislation or don't support the legislation. I heard a couple more tonight that I just want to clarify. One is if there's a conditional support. Councilmember McCullough had a question about that, which I think would be acceptable if you wanted to explore conditional support. Another one is we have a meeting on February 6th, which is before the February 15th. With the type of questions that I'm hearing, I'm not hearing the sorts of things that we're going to be able to have very complete answers for you by February 6th. I'm not necessarily recommending that. We can certainly give you a list of what all the other sales tax are in the state of California, but you're not going to have a list of what the projects are that would be included in the plan by then, or what the impacts would be different in the city of San Rafael versus a city that had a half a cent lower or something like that by that date. So another option is to take no action at all tonight, let this continue to play out at the other jurisdictions and at the TAM board, and let them pursue this without the specific support from the city of San Rafael. So I wanted to lay out that there's probably a couple more options out there than just the two that we included in the staff report.
Here's my only comment there, and I think you're absolutely right. The comment there would be that this is not to overplay our hand, but that would be tantamount to killing the deal. Because let's face it, if San Rafael is not on board, it's not going to go forward. At least that's my, I'm assuming at this point in time. So it's an endorsement of one idea or the other. If you want to use that word, I'd prefer not to, but if you want to use endorsement, the concept of creating an opportunity to address our transportation, our road repair needs, our potholes, et cetera, and to let the community decide what they wish to do. To me, it seems like there's no downside with regard to letting the public decide what it is that they wish. That's the way I look at it. So we're stifling that opportunity, and they can decide to pay or not pay. It's like going to the store. It's not real complicated. And so we're not making a hardcore decision. We're just saying, okay, we're going to let this thing go forward and see where, let the chips fall where they may. Not to do anything about some of these issues bothers me, because I'm getting a bunch of phone calls, and I'm sure you are too, along with the emails, et cetera, saying, why aren't you doing this, that, the other thing, roads and the intersections and so many other things that are facing the community. And we say, well, no, we're not going to do it right now. Why not let them decide? And they decide. I mean, two-thirds is a huge hurdle.
No, I understand.
And that is, if that passes, and I think we all might think that that's going to be a challenge, then that says that this community wants us to address our potholes.
I agree with you, but my main issue is I think we have time. This is 2017. Current Measure A doesn't expire until 2024-25. We have time, and this doesn't need to be a rushed issue. The voters are still going to, if we don't even have any projects ready for the ballot now, we're not going to have projects ready for the ballot maybe in 2018 or 2017, or we don't know that. And so what I'm saying is that if we defer this and it goes into the next legislative session and we're a year further down the road, we don't, you know, Measure A doesn't go away. The 50 cents does not go away. They're still using that. So I think we need more time. I know we need more time. I need more time to be able to support something like this. And I don't think waiting until a year from now and this gets brought back to us 6 months from now so that it is prepared in December or November, so that when the next legislative session happens in February of 2018, everything's ready to go and everybody's in support of it or not in support of it. But to do this now at this time without the input from our city and the citizens who've given us input, almost 100% on don't do anything at this point, give us more time to understand this, that's where I'm going.
Well, if I could ask one more question, and then we'll wrap this thing up, that relates to this timing issue. If we delay this, or defer it, if you wish, to a later date, 2 years, whatever the time frame might be, a later date, because we haven't specified that, what are the consequences? What are the consequences?
Well, there are a number of countywide needs that have been identified with respect to revenue sources. And there was one on the ballot this past November, childhood education and health care, that it's probably going to come back to voters in some fashion, perhaps after some repackaging. There's other issues, and you yourself, Mayor, have raised at the TAM board some of the issues that San Rafael would like to address through a revenue source, possibly sales tax in the future. So it is 2018 the right time for transportation? Could it be 2020? Could it be 2022? Possibly. I think the most difficult thing is how much need keeps being identified that we can't address with respect to not having the revenue available. Now, from a strict sense, we would not go to the ballot in 2018 if we don't have the capacity within the sales tax cap, period. So there is a quarter cent capacity. Maybe we would go to the ballot with a quarter cent, and that would use up the capacity available in San Rafael and Fairfax, for example. Right. It might also, it'll constrain, again, what several jurisdictions would be able to do in the future. But we have an expenditure plan. We have good projects. Everyone's behind it. Let's go to the ballot. Let's use up that quarter cent. Let's make it happen. That is an option for us to consider. could we get urgency legislation approved in 2018 that then lets us get on the ballot without the cap being an issue? Possibly. My understanding is likely not, that would be very difficult for the administration. That's not what we've seen in other counties in terms of how they've managed this process. By the way, all the other counties in the Bay Area that have pursued this have sought the raising the cap before the adoption of an expenditure plan. So they had their transportation authorities seek the legislation procedural step with the understanding and the guarantee that their member agencies would have a chance to say yes or no and determine the fate of what's in that expenditure plan. So, you know, that this has been a typical practice where they get the cap issue, the procedural allowance over here before they invest the money and the time developing the expenditure plan and engaging the public. So that's kind of been the nature. It would probably, if we don't do it this year, it could very well put us into, you know, a future year, 2020. And then really, the message is that, you know, should we do it then? What's the state of the economy then? What are the other needs that need to come to the ballot then? And is there room for transportation? Maybe each city will address transportation in your own sales taxes. You know, and that's an option too. So you're going to look at senior mobility and local road rehab and pedestrian improvements and additional transit. And that, you know, that's an option. TAM is willing to take on some of those needs, perhaps, with a renewal and a possible increase of the sales tax as a countywide forum. But, you know, the timing is such that, you know, we may actually be able to get the legislation sponsored this year with a deferral from you to wait and see what's on the ballot. But I find that doubtful. I think you're a principal player in terms of indicating a willingness to consider this. It really comes down to, are you willing to consider further discussion on this?
And let's just talk about that for a second. That is, in keying off Andrew's conditional, if you will, when the expenditure plan, if the expenditure plan came to us, how is that presented, and what are the consequences? Do we vote on the what do we do at that juncture?
Well, we would have a draft expenditure plan that would come from our expenditure plan broad committee, pass through the TAM board with, you know, whatever tweaks you want to recommend at that point, and I would come and present it, or my team, and I would say, look, here's what's in it. Plan A, 0.25 cent, plan B, 3/8, maybe zero. Here's what we can do with the existing sales tax. What do you think? And we would ask for your endorsement of one of those options. And we would go to each city and town. If we don't have approval from our major jurisdictions, we wouldn't go to the ballot. Could you represent a lot of those votes needed to get to that 2/3? So we'd be looking for your endorsement. It could be a two-step process. Well, can we get some more money for roads? And how about our citizens that are most needy? Can we look at some additional transit? You know, there'll be feedback that you may want to provide. And then we got a balancing act in terms of trying to get it right so that everybody.
Yeah, so there are a lot of avenues
back and forth.
But it strikes me, based on your comment, that certainly at that point in time, if the concerns expressed by my fellow council members, and I have the same concern, I must admit, because I haven't seen a list, so I don't, right. How do I assess whether or not it's a good idea for my, you know, vote? But at that point in time, if you came back with the plan and we thought it was great, we could say we endorse it. Mm-hmm. If we thought it was not adequate, it wasn't justified, it wasn't a good idea for whatever reason, then we could say that we don't. Mm-hmm. And it would have fairly profound consequences at that point in time, and I would suggest more meaningful, because now we're wrestling with some of those issues. We'll have an opportunity to hear from the community as to whether or not these are significant or not. Then we can take a vote that it's far more, I said, significant and meaningful, it seems to me. But absent that opportunity, you know, we're left without that exercise, which I would very much like to go through, simply because it's important to the community. So I still feel that there's that juncture that we can make that decision. And John, if I don't like it, I'm going to vote against it, just like you will. I don't have any problem doing that. But I certainly don't want to. I'm reticent to give up the opportunity to at least hear that presentation and that community gathering that you've talked about. And it has to be a pretty strong argument, I would suggest, for 2/3 vote. I mean, I've gone through elections with 2/3, and it's a tough one. I've gone through it with school districts. And if you don't have that thing nailed down, forget it. It's not going to happen. So this is a long ways from a done deal, folks.
One procedural question, Diane, maybe you can answer it for me. If the cap is raised, you know, and Tam goes through and McGuire sponsors legislation and it's approved, and so this cap is lifted for this piece, does that prohibit any other municipalities within Marin County from going forth and putting forth a ballot initiative for their own jurisdiction that would then limit TAM's ability to go out on a countywide basis and do something? So say the cap is lifted and San Rafael comes and says, we want to go ahead and put a 50-cent measure on the ballot for transportation that falls within that and handle it ourselves. Does that then limit TAM's ability to then go out and ask for an additional 50%?
Well, look, I'm going to answer simply. I don't know if I'm answering the exact question you're asking. With San Rafael at 9, you have a 0.25, a quarter cent capacity. If you choose to spend that on transportation, you choose to spend that on transportation. Our slice, it would be between 9.25 up to 9.75. Mm-hmm. Not saying we would do a full half cent, but let's have a conversation in the community and see what people are willing to support. So,
but I guess my question would be, if a cap is lifted,
yes.
So San Rafael is for the county, but so are we capped at 9.25 max, no matter what?
You're capped at a 9.25 max, no matter what. You can choose to use that quarter for anything that your council would support. But our little slice is for transportation countywide.
No, I understand.
Only.
But if you mentioned that the governor, you know, typically will approve these exemptions for transportation but not for general funding. So if the cap was lifted for transportation and San Rafael put its own bond for transportation, could we go above 9.25?
We've seen that happen with cities. Mm-hmm. I think we would have to make sure the legislation allows that. So we would have to say the county or any city seeking a transportation initiative specifically for transportation. There have been cities that have done that.
And if that was the case, then that would then impact TAM's ability to go to that 9.75?
Sure it would.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sure. May I ask a question? Sure. Just to try to bring this to perhaps a conclusion, at least as far as...
Good luck with that.
Yeah, I know. If we were to express our support for the resolution at hand, but condition it upon our ability to effectively veto any draft expenditure plan that were to come before us later after the cap is lifted, but before it goes out to the voters, would you be able to, and I'm thinking procedurally now, take that back to the TAM board and get their approval that... they agree to that condition, and that would be the condition upon which they would take our endorsement to Senator McGuire.
Well, I'd be more than happy to bring that to the TAM board. We're a multi-jurisdictional agency, and if we have 11, absolutely, let's allow the public to consider this, and one, we want to veto. I don't know exactly what they're going to do. I can't speak for them. However, I would venture to say that we are not going to go to the ballot and seek a 2/3 majority approval without the endorsement of our biggest city. So I would probably make that recommendation to the TAM board, that you need to understand the importance of that 2/3 challenge. And of San Rafael's role in meeting that 2/3, and take this into consideration. But I can't absolutely say what they'll do. There's a lot of interest in trying to address these transportation needs. So.
Yeah, I would come back, though, that and I don't think that that would be reasonable, quite frankly, to say we have veto powers over all the other jurisdictions of the county. I'd have a hard time defending that with a straight face, quite frankly. But I would come back to say that if, again, the expenditure plan doesn't meet our standards, let's say, whatever they might be, and needs, et cetera, then we can say we think it's a poor idea. And it's that before it goes to ballot, we can say we don't endorse it. We can make that statement, and that'll kill it. But we can make that statement. So we still have that judgment point, and it'll be profound. I mean, with all, you know. Sure.
Dan, how long would it take for Tam to prepare a draft expenditure plan?
Our current plan is to have that by December of 2017 through the involvement of an expenditure plan advisory committee.
Right, that's the full-on process. Right. But to just get a draft, or even a straw proposal, something, you know, a list of 10 projects that you're taking a hard look at that you would think would be in the expenditure plan, something that would be understood to be draft and just sort of a preliminary showing that there's good cause to lift this cap because we have a large selection of projects that we think the people should have the opportunity to vote on whether or not to fund.
I understand what you're saying. I think it's risky for us to presuppose what might be in an expenditure plan and for you to base an action on that until we have a thorough process of understanding what the needs are and what we're funding now, what we're challenged with not being able to fund because of other sources either not being eligible, like school bus service. There's no state or federal funds that are eligible for school bus service. So if we want to try and fund that, it's got to come from a local source. So we can educate on what we know, and we can start that education process immediately. But in terms of even a straw expenditure plan, I think we need to have a pretty thorough process to develop that.
Well, the problem with that is that you're basically coming here with a blank piece of paper.
Yes.
And trying to justify us to exercise our gatekeeping function and lift the cap.
And
so,
I recognize that.
There's your problem. Thank you.
Fully recognize
just
that.
Out of curiosity, in order to prepare an expenditure plan, will you have to use planning funds to do that?
You know, we're going to try and do that as much as possible with in-house sources.
Terrific.
My guess is to carry that further, because I think that's actually a reasonable request or certainly a good thought. My guess is, knowing you a little bit, that you could prepare a list of 12 items off the cuff to say these are areas that we are looking at, considering, or wrestling with. We know that they exist. And it wouldn't be an absolute guarantee, certainly, because the guarantee wouldn't come out until we had the expenditure list. But you could at least give this body and perhaps the others as well downstream a little better sense of the kinds of things, without commitments, but the kinds of projects that we might see on the expenditure list to satisfy that curiosity. Because it is, I got to agree with my colleagues, it is a blank sheet, and it's a little bit trying in that regard. But again, I would guess that you could come up with a reasonable list of items that we could at least consider.
Let me mention this. In June and July of 2014, we conducted a poll that the TAM board authorized on whether voters would consider an increase in the sales tax of a quarter cent for the following five items: for funding school bus service, local streets and roads, senior mobility, pedestrian improvements, and traffic operations on local roads, improvements in traffic operations. And as the poll went, we had a 68.25% okay, either strongly yes or likely yes, for those five elements. Now, those are going to be a starting point, obviously, for polling and for the TAM board and for you to engage and consider in an expenditure plan. So we have that evidence of what people are interested in. That was 2014. That was 3 years ago. You actually had a gentleman at the microphone talking about local roads. We've had continual interest in funding local and residential roads with more funding. And so if you want, I can say that we have evidence of those issues being of strong interest in the voting public's decision on this. I think there's other elements. I talked earlier about a few of them. The resiliency pot for sea level rise interchanges, those planning funds that we use to study some of the interchanges. We've got some very strong interest in Southern Marin about a couple of those interchanges. And those are some additional things we probably put in the mix. So there you go. Those are starting points for having the discussion. And we would probably, in the first meeting of the Expenditure Plan Advisory Committee, bring those poll results forward and say, here's a starting point for this.
Well, those five are certainly in areas of, I would suggest, areas of interest to all of us. Okay. Anything to wrap up? Any final comments, gentlemen? Okay. Then let's proceed with this this item to conclusion. Is there a motion with regard to the matter before us?
I would make a motion.
Okay.
As to item 6B, I move that we take no action at this time.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Councilmember Bushy.
Aye.
Councilmember Collin.
Oh, I said aye.
Councilmember Gamblin.
Aye.
Councilmember McCullough.
Aye.
Mayor Phillips.
No. The matter carries 4-1. Thank you very much. Long drawn out process.
Let's take a short break.